Y bueno, vamos a tener la suerte de contar con Luis de Sousa. Estábamos bromeando ahora con él, porque muchos de ustedes conocen, estoy seguro, a Manuel Villoria. Manuel Villoria fue el director académico del curso del verano pasado sobre los lobbies. Trabaja muy estrechamente en muchas iniciativas con la Oficina Antifraude. Es un colega con el que yo trabajo también muy a menudo. Y saben que es uno de los principales, en fin, directivos del capítulo español de Transparencia Internacional. Pues bromeaba con Luis de Sousa que le podía presentar como el Manuel Villoria portugués, porque tiene un perfil en realidad muy parecido al de Villoria. Es un muy buen académico, es alguien especializado en el tema del análisis de la corrupción desde diversas perspectivas, es un experto en temas de financiación de partidos, pero no solo en ese tema, también es uno de los mejores expertos a nivel europeo, por lo menos, sobre corrupción en el ámbito local. Y por tanto tocamos muchos temas en común con Manuel Villoria y demás, solo que ellos además tienen ese gran papel en Transparencia Internacional. Luis es el presidente del capítulo portugués de Transparencia Internacional. Con Manuel Villoria también coincide en una cosa, y es que los dos son los investigadores locales, los corresponsales de la investigación local de la Comisión Europea. Es este equipo de investigadores que han hecho el primer borrador a partir del cual nació el primer informe de la Unión Europea sobre la corrupción en el ámbito europeo, este informe que se presentó el año pasado. Es decir, muchas cosas en común con Manuel Villoria. Aparte de eso, Luis es doctor por el Instituto Universitario Europeo de Florencia. Es fellow de la Edmund Safra Network de la Universidad de Harvard y es catedrático ahora en la Universidad de Aveiro, catedrático de Ciencia Política en la Universidad de Aveiro. Además de eso, de ser el presidente de Transparencia Internacional Portugal, también es el coordinador de una red que se dedica al análisis de las agencias anticorrupción, que se llama Anchorage Net. Es el coordinador de esa red y es consultor de un montón de organismos internacionales, entre otros el programa Sigma de la OCDE, es en general del Consejo Europa también, de distintos aspectos del Consejo Europa, de la Comisión Europea y del Programa de Desarrollo de la ONU. Es decir, que tiene toda una trayectoria académica y profesional y como consultor en el campo del análisis de la corrupción y en el campo también del estudio de las medidas anticorrupción realmente interesante. Pues Luis, estamos encantados de tenerte aquí y quería darte las gracias por haber aceptado la invitación. Sé además que ha tenido unos días realmente complicados. Ayer tuvo una importante entrevista en Lisboa que tuvo que hacerle retrasar su incorporación aquí a Barcelona, su viaje de llegada a Barcelona, y esta tarde mismo nos tiene que dejar porque mañana tiene también una importante reunión en Bruselas, y bueno, así anda Luis, o sea que muchísimas gracias.
Muchas gracias, Fernando. Buenas tardes a todas y a todos. Es con mucho placer que estoy aquí. Quería agradecer a la Oficina Antifraude la invitación. Ya he trabajado anteriormente con distintos miembros de la Oficina Antifraude en estas evaluaciones internacionales que hacemos, y fue un placer porque hay gente muy competente y muy informada de comparativamente de lo que se hace en materia de combate a la corrupción. Yo os voy a pedir perdón porque mi nivel de español no es muy malo, creo, pero el problema es que con términos técnicos es un poquito difícil de hacer la gestión, ¿no? Con una lengua extranjera que no tengo formación de base, que la he aprendido como todos los portugueses guardando la televisión española, así que os voy a pedir disculpa y voy a cambiar para el inglés, que no es ni mi lengua ni vuestra lengua. Pido perdón por eso, pero creo que será más claro el raciocinio y lo que tengo para vos decir, sobre todo después del almuerzo, ¿no? Que están seguramente más será un poco más difícil de tener vuestra atención. Pues voy a cambiar, si tenéis que utilizar la auricular ahora, voy a cambiar para en inglés. We've been talking about party financing regulation this morning and party financing supervision. The first thing that I would like to tell you, and this is not any novelty for you, you've been working on the field, some of you as practitioners, some of you as controllers, some as academics. The issue of party financing is not a new issue. I mean, it's been there since the 19th century, since parties began to create and to be this modern sort of organizations that compete for power. And this man, this German sociologist, Max Weber, was perhaps the first one that raised the critical issue about party finance when he said that it's among the most important and yet, for obvious reasons, the least transparent chapters of party history. And we were still in the turn of the 19th century to the 20th century, when mass parties were being created and sort of a lot of mobilization was taking place, a lot of fundraising was taking place also to create a structure for these parties. And besides that, the first, probably the first rule ever on party financing was implemented in the United States back in 1867. And that had to do with public officials in the shipyards collecting funds for candidates, which was prohibited then. And then the prohibition was extended to other public officials a couple of years later. So we're talking about 19th century. Till now, a lot of things have changed because party systems have changed, the electoral competition has changed. We have a new variable which is very important, which is television. Television is omnipresent in all electoral campaigns. That is pushing competition to the limit sometimes, and it becomes sort of an arms race. Like in the Cold War period, you had this arms race between the contenders, pretty much the same. And that forces party in this very sensitive period to seek for additional funds, which some of them are obviously not foreseen under the regulations. So the three core dimensions of the problem that Max Weber identified are still valid today as they were at the turn of the 19th century. He identified these three core dimensions of the problem of political financing. One of them had to do with the undue influence, the improper influence that political financing can have on public policy. The fact that through financing, particular groups can exert influence on decision makers, and so party financing can determine how power is distributed in democracy. The second thing he said was that this is overall a very opaque activity, okay? So lack of transparency. It was back then in the 19th century, it is still today, despite all the regulations that we've put in place. The third thing is the competitive nature of elections that drives political parties to intensify their campaigns, to intensify their initiatives to mobilize voters, especially the undecided voters. And this may cause an escalation of costs which are sometimes disproportionate to their legal, institutional, financial capacity. So they have to seek additional sources in a very short period, because elections, you know, they run for very short periods. So that exposes parties to this additional pressure, and sometimes, especially in party systems where you have strong competition between two major parties, but even coalitions, it can be two coalitions. I mean, it's not that's not the issue. Fact is, where you have high level of competition in the party system, that certainly and you have, if you have asymmetries among competitors, that may also create some problems in terms of their search for additional funds. So these three core elements that he raised regarding to political financing are still pretty much a concern for decision makers, for legislators today, when we discuss issues about regulation, how far should regulation go, what should it cover, etc. Now, we've said a couple of things this morning, and I'm just restating some of the reasons why unregulated party financing may be a threat to democracy. We know that elections are quite essential to the definition of democracy. We know that without elections, without a competitive party system, we're not really in presence of a fully fledged democracy. And the major function of political parties, although we can discuss other noble functions, but the major function is to run for office and to win elections. Of course, I know that there are parties that say, no, we have other functions, we also educate people, we also this. True. But the major function is still pretty much to compete for power through elections. And the problem is that there are no elections without actions of campaigning, as I said earlier. And these actions of campaigning, they have means which are allocated for each of these single actions. You know, the campaign is a collection of actions. It can be public speech of a politician, followed by maybe a musical band. It can be just collecting a fundraising activity, a dinner or something. All these activities, they have means which are allocated to them. And these means have a price. They have a value. And this is the issue, the fact that you cannot run campaigns without money. Now, we heard earlier on saying that these new movements and these new parties are doing this sort of crowdfunding via the social networks, and they're getting, again, these small contributions, and that money is not everything. Well, money is not everything. There are exceptions. Of course, we're talking very exceptional cases. For the majority, the vast majority of the party systems, as my former supervisor, who is a French expert in these matters, used to say, l'argent est au centre du système. And you cannot, in fact, think of representative system without elections that spend, you know, quite considerable amounts of money to diffuse ideas, programs, etc. Of course, we know that there are countries who have more modest campaigns than others, and that's, we'll come to that in a moment. So there is a real risk that electoral processes can be unduly influenced by sizable or undisclosed amounts of money which are donated either to parties or to candidates. And these actors, they don't simply give money because they sympathize with the cause. Truly, yes, this is part of the issue. But sometimes donations are also given in order to influence the course of certain policy. I could, for instance, bring back the case of Bernie Ecclestone and the Formula One affair in the UK, in which a party donation was associated to changes in the regulation of the tobacco industry and advertising of the tobacco industry in Formula One. So, you know, the two things sometimes are associated, but as Astrid said this morning, not all corruption is related to party financing, to be clear. So the quality of government can be seriously compromised by this undue influence of money. Now, so why do we regulate very I try to be as synthetic as I can, because we already discussed this during the morning session. We regulate not just to fight corruption. In fact, perhaps we regulate, and that might be the first reason, to create appropriate conditions for party pluralism, for new ideas to come up, for some fairness in the competitive game that are elections. But we also regulate to protect political actors from undue influence of money, and that should be clear. We also regulate to reduce informality. Someone mentioned earlier this morning about fraud and informal economy and all that. Truth. In fact, that indicator, it's a very interesting proxy indicator of how successful regulation can be. Because if we look at the way this informal economy is calculated, and we have in our countries around 30% or 40% of informal economy, and we say that basically 30% means that 30% of the business transactions in the country are not accounted for. If they are not accounted for companies, do you believe that should be the case or should not be the case with regards to parties? I'm asking. I'm not stating. But just consider, if you have the same informality in the business sector, why should it be different in the party system? So to set clear standards of financial probity both to the supply side and demand side of political financing is another reason why we regulate. We also regulate because we want parties to be accountable for the public money they receive for their campaigns. And there's a trade-off, we already spoke about that during the morning. Also to prevent the biased use of political financing enforcement mechanisms to use as a sort of weapon against the opponents. And that has happened in several countries. The overall objective, of course, is to restore levels of public trust in the party system, especially in the last few years. If we look at public opinion indicators on trust, Sam was showing them this morning, you see the trend, the overall trend is declining levels of trust in parties, especially conventional parties. Now, what has been the context of reform in the various, and I'm just focusing on European democracies, okay? I'm not looking at Latin American democracies or other regions of the world, I'm just focusing on European democracies. The context of reform has been a context of succession of scandals in different democracies. And Fernando has studied a lot this issue, so I'm not even, I won't address the truth is that through these various cases, what we notice is that there is, as Max Weber said, a world of opacity. There's little transparency over real estate and heritage assets of political parties. If you ask your party systems, how did you get your headquarters around the country? Alas, what do you call it? Las sedes. How did you get them? I asked the same question in my country. Now, the only discussion that we've been arguing the last few days is the fact that parties have this indirect public funding, which is tax exemption. And they have tax exemption for property taxes. And so there was one of these movements recently questioned how much parties are gaining of tax exemption when everybody else is paying, and, you know, this sort of, which is a bit of a populist argument, because let's face, there is indirect and direct public funding to parties, and this is a form of indirect public funding, and it's quite accountable, because the tax office knows how much property tax exemption is giving to party A, party B, party C. That is not the question. The question is not the tax exemption. The question is, how did you get the property in the first place? That is the question that is not answered. and has not been answered in our case, and many countries, some countries that we've been surveying in this international consultancy project, and we discovered that the pattern is quite common to other European democracies. The other issue is there's little transparency about party financing practices that fall outside the legal framework, as I was telling earlier. Third-party spending. You know, you have a campaign, there's the official campaign, and there's the unofficial campaign parallel to the to this one. You know, there's this group of people who got organized, and they're supporting the candidate, and you know, and you ask, do they have a legal personality? No, they don't. Do they fall under the scope of the regulation? No, they don't. Yes, but they are promoting the candidate the same way. You know, they are spending money to promote the candidate. Therefore, this is electoral expenditure. Yes, but falls outside the regulation. Therefore, the regulator cannot touch that. So you can have extra money spent by third parties, and also the issue of donations in kind also that we discussed this morning. Little transparency regarding the relationship, and this is quite crucial, the relationship between parties and a series of other players, PR agencies, banks, support movements. All these entities fall outside most of the regulations. And yet, parties get bank loans. Sometimes we don't even know in certain regulations, we can not even know what were the terms of those loans that they got. Not to mention that the banks that often give the loans are also have also a series of contracts with the state that have been they are the financiers of some public-private partnership or other contract of the state, and the party in office that has granted that that contract is also contracting a loan with this bank. So, you know, it raises issues. I'm not saying that there is necessarily a sort of quid pro quo, but it certainly raises issues regarding to the purview of regulation. But we also saw a series of patterns of illegal activities. Setting up front organizations, either think tanks, foundations, you know, you have the Urba Affair in France. This was the creation of this fictitious unit to channel money through the local municipalities of the Socialist Party for faked projects, and in fact all the money was being used for party financing purposes. You had the same tentative in Portugal. Fortunately enough, our president at the time blocked this, the creation of this this entity. You have the smuggling of slush funds into party coffers, especially from state-owned companies, but also via public tendering. You have false company invoicing. You have the use of offshore accounts for certain third-party expenditure. You have also, in some cases, in some countries, a growing penetration of transnational organized crime and illicit funds into politics. So yeah, there's a lot of practices that have been detected either by investigative journalism or by the work, the investigative work of anti-corruption agencies or the conventional judicial authorities. The fact is that we've been detecting certain patterns that tend to repeat from country to country. The same way we have institutional isomorphism for good things, we also have it for bad things. So most of the countries have often legislated in reaction to scandal. And this is a very difficult context to legislate. There's a lot of pressure from public opinion. Often the legislation comes in anticipation of elections. So you have this image issue to solve before the elections. So you want to play the good guy, and you initiate these transparency packages or these anti-corruption reforms just before the next electoral cycle. This is part of the folklore of anti-corruption, as Gunnar Myrdal used to write about this. And this has led to a poor quality legislation in terms of party financing in many countries. Either you have what we call imperfect laws that have solid and clear norms of action, but they are completely deprived of adequate mechanisms to implement those norms and to guarantee their effective application and enforcement, or you have these cosmetic laws characterized by norms that have fictitious applicability and that do not curtail the improper conduct of the agents of parties in this case. In most cases, you have not had what Fernando was saying this morning. You didn't have a regulatory impact assessment of these regulations. We keep pouring regulations to countries on political, I'm talking about a political system regulation, either conflicts of interest or party financing or assets declaration, etc. But there has been no serious assessment of the effectiveness of some of these measures. And so regulatory impact assessments in this area are still almost non-existent. On the other hand, not only the legal framework, we have this cumbersome legislation, also at the institutional level, we have created a series of new bodies to supervise the regulation of party financing. Either we have allocated this competence to existing bodies, such as the case in Spain with Tribunal de Cuentas, or we have created new bodies. In the case of Portugal, we had a dual monitoring system which was completely dysfunctional for 10 years. Okay, we had campaign accounts were going to the National Elections Commission and annual accounts of party were going to the Constitutional Court. There was no cross-check of the information whatsoever. So it was completely dysfunctional. After 2003, they decided to create one single political financing monitoring body in the Constitutional Court, so they moved the campaign accounts to the Constitutional Court, to this new entity. Now, they've created a special offer for this new entity, who actually says the entity is independent, but the entity is not independent. It's just an administrative annex of the Constitutional Court. And the Constitutional Court, as you know, it's a very special judicial body with specific functions, and certainly I'm completely against of giving functions of checking the morality in political life to the Constitutional Court. The Constitutional Court has very specific functions. Check the constitutionality of laws. This is it. When you add new functions to bodies that were not meant in the first place to address those issues, you might lose in both ends. You might start making this body that probably was working well and was doing well to get a bad image on the minor functions, which are the supervision of assets and the supervision of party financing in the case of Portugal. Anyway, I'm not going in detail on that, just saying that new state bodies have been created or some existing bodies have been allocated these tasks to monitor, to supervise political financing regulation. And there is a very interesting element in this process, which makes us bring back this theory on this organization theory of institutional isomorphism. And I'm sorry of being a little bit theoretical just now in this slide, because this explains a lot of the insuccess of some of these agencies. The same applies also for anti-corruption agencies. Basically, what the theory of both DiMaggio and Powell says that there are three types of institutional isomorphism. Either by mimetism, by coping measures or institutions that have been created elsewhere, and we often do that without taking into consideration the context in which they were created. And when we look at anti-corruption agencies, for instance, a lot of countries said, we love the Hong Kong model. The Hong Kong model is the reference. Everybody loves the Hong Kong model. Yeah, but you have to see the context in which it was created. You have to look at the surrounding, the institutional surrounding, because, of course, these agencies do not work on their own. And there's no point of creating a fully-fledged party financing supervisory body with a lot of nice competences, a lot of resources, when everything else around it, it's not working, because these bodies do not work in a vacuum, in an institutional vacuum. You know, they need to cooperate with the judiciary police, with anti-corruption agencies, with prosecutional services, with the parliament, with a lot of bodies, with civil society as well. Another form of institutional government, which is also important, is coercive. A lot of these bodies have been created because, either by suggestion, it's almost, I put suggestion in inverted commas, because it's a strong pressure of either the European Commission or the Council of Europe saying, you should perhaps, I'm not saying that you must, but you should perhaps consider the creation of these specialized bodies. So you have some of these young democracies like Montenegro and, you know, building up their arsenal of institutions and all that, and all in a dysfunctional, disarticulated way. And then you have this normative institutional isomorphism, which is part of the fact that a lot of the staff of these agencies also participate in conferences, in training actions like this one, where there is a lot of knowledge transfer about what the others do. This morning we had the case of Norway, we had the case of Spain, maybe I'll talk a little bit about the case of Portugal, and you start, you know, assimilating, saying, ah, in Portugal they do this way, perhaps we should do, but often decontextualizing how things were decided and adopted in a specific country. So a lot of these agencies resemble in terms of format, in terms of competences, but in what comes to procedure and levels of performance, they tend to be quite different from one country to the other. And yet again, there has been no capacity assessment, institutional capacity assessment of these agencies across the various European countries. So we don't really know whether they're performing well, whether not performing well, etc. We heard this morning about non-bureaucratic appointment procedures for the head staff of some of these supervisory bodies. It's true. It's true, I'm afraid. And that often compromises the whole business of an independent and impartial supervision of party financing. Now, with regards to public opinion, I won't say much, just that the fact that, yes, in the current conjuncture, in the current context, we are facing a serious problem in terms of parties being, especially conventional parties, being completely discredited, and therefore one of the questions that Fernando asked this morning is how much of this regulation, how much of this supervision is changing people's perceptions about party life, especially in what concerns their financing. And in a lot of countries it's not changing a thing. It's not changing a thing. So what happens actually when we look at the poor and the good performers, okay, thank you, we can see that there are countries that show quite a positive perception of political financing transparency and supervision, and there are countries who don't. But when we actually, sorry, I'll just move a little bit further, when we cross perceptions of party corruption, as Fernando did, with regulation, you see that there are countries such as Norway and some of the Scandinavian countries, Nordic countries, that have very little regulation, and yet the level of appropriation of those rules, the level of perceived party corruption is quite low. Now, I'm sure some of you have visited some of these countries, and some of you probably were there during electoral periods. One of the funny things is that if you're there during an electoral period, you almost forget that they are in elections, because you don't see anything out in the streets. It's very discreet, it's very modest. The campaigns tend to be quite modest. If you go to Portugal, and in the words of a former politician who is now in a very difficult situation, in Portugal he used to say, this is the party of the democracy is a big party. What he meant is that, you know, that you need to canvass voters, you need to mobilize voters, so you spend a lot of money in concerts, in dinners, in creating these elements of panisircense to invite people for something that they are not motivated. In fact, you even pay buses to collect people to come to these events, because you know that at 8 o'clock, when the televisions are focusing on you, you have to have a whole crowd behind you to say that you are, you know, mobilizing voters and you are being successful in your campaign. So the fact is that we have countries that are quite contained in terms of the electoral expenses, and countries who are not. We have countries that tend to take seriously regulations, and countries that see regulations as something to as a sort of an exception to the orthodoxy of their financing. Now, what issues should we address in terms of setting up a political financing supervisory body? If we look at several, I mean, there are several reports. IDEA did a fantastic report on party financing, and also has a chapter dedicated to political financing supervision, but also USAID, ORSE, GRECO, also in their evaluations, they have a part dedicated to the supervisory body. So there's a lot of information out there. If you want to check, there's a lot of information out there about what are the good practices, let's put it this way, or the questions we should ask ourselves when setting up these type of bodies. Well, there's a dimension of accountability. To who should the political financing supervisory body report? This is not a minor issue, because obviously you want this body to be accountable. It has to be accountable to someone, okay, of what they do. The resources, the human, material, and financial resources which are needed to fulfill the assigned tasks. The correlation between the mission objectives and the funding. The independence of these bodies, both in operational and political terms. I mean, you have the question of who nominates the head staff, whether they are immune to political pressure by threat or fear of discharge, whether the supervisory bodies are allowed or expected to develop their own communication strategy, whether they have fully administrative and operational autonomy, whether their budget is inscribed in the state budget or not, whether it depends on the budget of another ministry, or which creates obviously certain political constraints. Regulatory powers. Not all of these bodies have regulatory capacity. We heard this morning about the Tribunal de Cuentas. It's pretty much the same job that the Entidade das Contas does in Portugal. It's rubber stamp monitoring. Okay, you receive the accounts of parties. They might have been internally audited by the internal audits of the party. Might, because in some countries it's voluntary. It's not required by law. And basically, either them or subcontracting that to an auditing firm, they will check the accounts as submitted. Now, obviously, that's not enough. That's not enough because of the issue that I was mentioning earlier of third-party expenditure. How much of the accounts, how much of the accounts which are submitted by parties reflect the real transactions that parties are making? And yet again, I go back to what we said earlier. If we think that businesses, 30% of their transactions are informal, are not declared, are informal economy, why should we think otherwise for political parties? Investigative powers, whether the new body will be able to carry out on-site inspections or not, inquiries or joint investigations, and how are these investigations to be carried out, with what powers and scope. The institutional cooperation with other bodies, it's very important. The only case after the first regulation was adopted in 1993 in Portugal. So we're now talking about 20 years of regulated context, of a regulated party financing context. We had 20 years of non-regulated, not 20, 19, of non-regulated party financing in Portugal, from 1974 until 1993. In 20 years, we had a lot of practices that have crystallized. We have a lot of assets that parties have gained that they cannot justify. The regulation came quite late and in a very cumbersome way. And since then, we have changed the law every 2 years, almost, at the rate of every 2 years. That's no good. But in the last 20 years, we had a regulated context. And so far, we only had one case of illicit financing detected. And it was detected because someone was very imprudent. Someone left a post-it. Believe it, I'm not joking. You know the post-it, this yellow sticker that you put on things? On a bill that was paid by a construction firm of the billboards of a particular party. And the tax office was making an investigation to this public relation agency and discovered this bill. What does it mean? Payable to blah blah blah. What does this sticker mean? And after that, the whole investigation started, and they discovered that it was a construction firm who eventually paid these electoral expenses of one of the parties, and they got convicted. But in fact, the conviction, the penalty should be 1 year imprisonment. But they decided for the least heavy penalty, which was also, I think, not the best message to send out in a context where people are so upset with the corruption related to parties. The first time you discover one case and you're going to give the minimal sentence. I'm not in favor of populist and judicialist solutions, but at the same time, I don't think it was smart to give the least penalty in that situation. But anyway, it was done. So in 20 years, just one case. And the level of cooperation between these bodies, between the judiciary, police, and entidade de contas, the political financing supervisory body, and the prosecution office, the attorney general office, levels of cooperation are really poor. The fact is that they don't communicate well. They have different logics also of working, and sometimes it's not easy. And just to give you also an idea that one of the problems behind this is the fact that the political class has not seen party financing as an opportunity structure for political corruption. They have not fully understood that link. To the extent that they have created a Corruption Prevention Bureau, Corruption Prevention Council it's called, in the Court of Accounts, and the political financing supervisory body is not even part of that new council. It's almost as saying, you know, we have corruption and then we have party financing. It's a different issue. Which is not. And we know that a lot of the contracts, a lot of commissions, illicit commissions, have been extracted from contracts to finance political parties, both at the local and national level. And so this is certainly a source of concern and should be given priority, top priority in the political agenda. I think I'm almost coming to an end. I just want briefly say what the challenge to regulation on how to harmonize these regulations and leveling the playing field. We have different democratic systems around Europe, different government systems, different states, different electoral systems, and all this complicates when you translate that into legislation on party financing. You have different constitutional frameworks also. We discussed, for instance, issues such as freedom of speech. We have court rulings in the United States saying you shouldn't put caps, ceilings on donations, because that's a violation of expression of freedom of expression. So these are not minor issues, because once you start discussing the regulation, all these issues come up. Or, for instance, why should every donation be paid with a bank transfer and with a check? Why? If we say that donations, it's a way of expressing our political sympathy for one party or the other, and if this is a constitutional right, then the question is very simple. If I don't have a bank account, am I constitutionally obliged to have a bank account? This is an issue that the Communist Party raised in Portugal. It's a very, very interesting issue in regulatory terms. We may agree, we may not agree, but we have to discuss it when we come to frame the regulation. Different political parties also. We talked about these new protest parties with different ways of organizing, different ways of financing. Conventional parties, parties that have been in office for many years, parties that have never been in office, parties that have a very strongholds in local government, parties who are have a more loose structure. All these have implications with regards to the way we'll frame the party financing regulation. To conclude, we said that the supervisory bodies have different formats with different capacities and levels of performance. Now, they nevertheless display common challenges. Overall, we have a very cumbersome legislation in a lot of countries. We have unbalanced principles, we have unclear operational concepts. For instance, if I ask you, what is the concept of fundraising? In a lot of regulations, we have saying in the sources of financing of parties, we include fundraising activities. Yes, but what do we mean by fundraising activities? It means different things for different parties. And I'm not going to give you examples, but I can give you later if you want, because I'm already running out of my time. Insufficient independence of these political financing supervisory bodies, either in financial terms, operational terms, or in terms of to whom they need to report. Lack of resources. Most of them are understaffed, underfinanced, but they have to fulfill a lot of tasks. This is the best way to kill a specialized body. Some have to look at not only at party financing, but now have to look at internal elections, internal to political parties, elecciones primarias. Now, if you look at the structure of 3-5 people, how on earth are they going to manage this? It's impossible. And this could be a way of killing the unit. You overcharge the unit, basically. Low security of tenure or non-specialized or non-meritocratic ways of recruiting the staff. It's also problematic. Lack of political support or the opposite, undesirable political interference such as threat of budget cuts or removal of head officials. We've known cases where this has happened. Most of these agencies have precarious complaint systems. And another issue is the communication with civil society. Civil society plays quite a strong role in this process. A lot of civil society organizations sometimes are doing the job that political financing supervisory bodies cannot deliver. For instance, monitoring cost campaigns, the campaign costs. Monitoring or making these reports together with academia about informal practices of political financing, as someone mentioned earlier on. And this is some of the tasks that actually these bodies should be delivering. But, you know, if you have very little resources and you've not been trained to that effect, it doesn't come naturally, you know, it doesn't come naturally. So the best option sometimes is to create this cooperation with civil society organizations. In fact, as Fernando said, the Political Finance Supervisory Board in Portugal, when it was created, they initiated this together with academia. They did a cost monetary action in loco with 50 monitors, 50 political financing monitors. And at least they managed to see more or less what was going on in the terrain, to see whether some informal practices on fundraising initiatives or the type of cost structure that the campaigns had. You know, that kind of information you don't get at sitting in the office and reading the report that you receive from political parties, which is just pure accounting, bookkeeping. So you need to be more proactive in that sense. The political financial providers need to be more proactive and need to engage, need to create this bridge. If they don't have the capacity, they need to seek it elsewhere. And sometimes academia, sometimes civil society organizations can offer some help. Obviously, they are not a long-term solution because the unit should develop its own internal capacity to produce these sort of studies, but at least they can try to overcome these difficulties in the early stage of their work. And the communication strategy of these agencies, it's absolutely important. If we said that one of their functions is to restore public trust in parties, if you don't know how to communicate your results to citizens, if you show the certification of accounts 5 years after they've been submitted, forget it. This is meaningless. Actually, that creates even more the suspicion that this all apparatus that you've created, the regulation, that's provided, was meant just to give the impression that you are doing something, but you are not taking it seriously. So I would just conclude here. Thank you for your attention. I see that some of you are already a bit tired, so I apologize for being too long. And if you have more questions, I can answer afterwards.
No creo que tuve más que 45 minutos.
Bueno, vamos con la mesa redonda. Si quieren los ponentes subir.